The following is brought to you by Sports Radio New York.
Welcome a man who spent the part of five seasons with the New York Islanders from 1985 through the 1989-90 season. His best season with the team was in 87-88 when he notched 36 goals and 76 points for the team during the regular season. I want to welcome former Islanders forward Mikko Makela to the program. Mikko, thanks for coming on the show.
Thank you very much.
Mikko, I mentioned that 87-88 season is probably your best season with the team from a statistical standpoint, but the year prior, in 86-87, you were part of a team that made a very memorable comeback in the first round of the Pacific Division playoffs. That was the first season the NHL changed from a five-game playoff to a seven-game playoff, and as luck would have it, you guys found yourself down 3-1 against the Caps that season, and you guys made quite a memorable comeback that year.
Yes, we had a pretty good team, obviously, that year, and just too bad that we couldn't get after that any further, but yeah, it was a lot of fun.
Now, you won game five. My notes here tell me you won 4-2, and you won the next game 5-4 at home, and the seventh game is the one I really want to talk to you about, because that was a game that went into four overtimes, and Pat LaFontaine sent you guys to the finals of the Pacific Division that year, but that had to have been one of the most more memorable games of your career, not only as an Islander.
Yeah, it was a lot of fun. Yeah, that game when after the first overtime period, everybody was still really upbeat, and yeah, let's go.
Right.
And when we went to the last one, we were pretty tired. we just concentrated on playing. Just so funny, we had a lot of chances. Actually, both teams had a lot of chances in the overtime, but just both goalies were unbelievable. Kelly for us, especially. So, and then how the goal ended up, how bad he just shoots the puck towards the net and goes in. That
right.
was pretty pretty good relief. And I know that a lot of people in the stands, too, they were happy that game was over because there was a half of stands there. I think that they were sleeping already.
I think it was 4 in the morning when the game ended, something like that.
I thought that was 2:05 in the morning, but we played about 6 hours that day. So
that had to be tried. Like you said, it's curious. I was going to ask you about that, too. The first overtime, you know, guys are all geared up. We're going to get the game winning by the fourth overtime. You guys must have been really great. Were guys still saying they were going to score the game winner by the fourth overtime? You guys were just pretty much sitting quiet in the locker room, getting your rest before the next period.
Well, yeah, I think that what happened actually there too is, and I'm not quite sure about this, but what I heard that Washington's trainer helped us get us all kinds of fruit and all oxygen and everything.
Really?
So I heard that he was not there next year.
Really?
Because of that. Yeah. But it was a lot of difficulty. Obviously, nowadays players have I don't know how many pair of gloves they have. We only have pair and barely never dry them between the periods. What they do now.
Right.
So they were pretty wet after the game, so was the skates. So, yeah, you could almost pour just water out of the skates, too, after the game.
It's true. And nowadays, with the technology and everything else, it seems like they're changing games 2, 3, 4 times a game. And here you guys were, you know, think about things like that. How it was a lot different back then.
Yeah, exactly.
So no one mentioned that they were going to get the game winner in the locker room. It just kind of, LaFontaine just kind of was the Johnny on the spot.
Well, yeah, and obviously everybody still talk about it. Let's get her done, boys, and all this stuff. So,
right.
Yeah, we still, but it was just not as hype as after first overtime period.
Well, that was certainly a memorable game. I remember watching it at home on TV, and it's definitely exciting. Definitely one that I'm going to remember, and I'm sure all the guys on that team are going to remember for a long time.
Well, definitely, like, you guys were part of that, and we were part of that, so that was a special time.
Well, as I mentioned, your best season with the Islanders was the following season. It also happened to be the same year that former Islander great Mike Bossy was the last year he played with the team. He had his worst season as an Islander that year, scoring only 38 goals in 63 games. Can you imagine having such a terrible season like that?
Well, yeah, and a lot of people don't know, but he couldn't even tie his skates up, so the trainer had to put his skates on. I don't think he even practiced once with the team, so he just played the games and still come up with the numbers like that. I mean, that is unbelievable.
Yeah, and for those who don't know, of course, Mike had a lot of back problems late in his career, but to score 38 goals in 63 games without being able to lace up your skates is quite a feat. So did you get a chance, though, to know Mike at all? Did he help you with your game in any?
Oh, yeah. Like, Trotz and him, you know, they were one of the greatest pairs ever in the NHL. So, I mean, just watching them and everyday practices and how they did things, that definitely helped a lot for a younger player. And that was a big treat for I know not just for me, but rest of the younger players too, to watch them.
Sure. Now, we mentioned, of course, that quadruple overtime game is one of the more memorable games, but are there any other moments with the Islanders that stand out for you during your time on Long Island?
Oh, there's many, especially against the Rangers, many games. And after that, when we went from Washington, we flew home. We got home around 6, 7 o'clock in the morning, and right away that same morning we left to Philadelphia and played there. Afternoon game, so things like that, they're just still in my mind, and like yesterday. Obviously, the island was a special place for me. I moved there when I was 20 years old and lived there till I was 25, so that's a pretty special time in the
sure.
young man's life. That is definitely my, I consider that as a second home. I know the shortcuts there, and every time when I get to Long Island, it just feels pretty special.
Now, you guys used to go, I think they still go there now, Vincent's Clam Bar. Is that a popular spot you guys used to go to back in the day? What are some of the places you went around on the island?
Oh, what is that?
Vincent's Clam Bar. I think a lot of the islanders went. Remember that place?
Is that in the North Port?
That's on, it was an Old Country Road right by the Meadowbrook Parkway there. Italian place. You guys can go there a lot, I remember.
Well, that could have been in the playoff time, because we had to stay in the hotel around there. So,
Well, are there any particular incidents, or maybe something happened in the locker room or off the ice? There's something funny that happened. I talked to Brad Delgarno on the show a while back, and he mentioned how Kasparaitis brought in some crazy music from the Lion King for the locker room one day, and how it was like a riot. So, do you have any stories like that?
I'm sure that there's a lot of stories, but now when I just quickly think about it, usually Pat LaFontaine and myself, we lived really close together in Northport, and most of the time after practice, we took a little run from the locker room to our cars and then see who's home first.
a little race.
So one particular time I remember, it just rained and the road.